Now, here's a little interesting electronics gadget, you know, for the tinkerers and, you know, the Arduino people out there. Well, what we have today is an 8x8 LED matrix. The way in which it works is extremely interesting, and I've been having a lot of fun with it, you know, just on the basis of how it works. So today, let's delve into it. Let's actually, you know, try to understand better, you know, what's going on with this particular piece of kit. Now, in this video, we will be delving into a little bit of physics and math. You know, we'll be doing a little bit of Ohm's law calculations. Don't be too alarmed by that, right? Hopefully it will all make sense. If you'd like to find out more about this, I have also written a companion blog post. So do pop open the video description, you'll find a link to that. We'll have, you know, little code snippets as well as even perhaps some downloads that you can take a look at. So with that said, let us jump into this random Wednesday episode. Hello and welcome back to another random Wednesday episode. So today we're going to be talking about the 8x8 LED matrix. In fact, we have so much to say about it that we are probably not going to fit it all in one video. So yeah, be prepared to get another video in maybe 2 or 3 weeks time. We will, well, delve a little bit deeper into this particular component. As mentioned, this particular component is interesting because of how it operates. Let's take a look at what that means. So of course, the question is, how do we actually power 64 LEDs with just 16 pins? As it turns out, it's actually quite ingenious. And, you know, in order to properly understand this, we're going to have to actually delve into the innards of, well, the LED matrix itself. Now, basically, these LEDs are connected together using a grid of wires. So exactly like this, right? They're split into rows and columns. So yeah, what you can then do is you can set one of the rows to a high state. In other words, it's actually receiving power. Then you can set one of the columns to low state. In other words, going to ground, of course, through a resistor. But we'll talk about the resistor stuff later on. The idea is, once you have a row and column connected like this, one of the LEDs will light up. And well, the reason for this is you've basically created a complete path for a current to flow. So yeah, what this means is you can basically sort of address any pixel by just appropriately powering its corresponding row and column. Now, one thing that may not be quite as intuitive is in the fact that, well, the pins are not actually sort of in order. So what you're looking for here is the top of the LED matrix, which has the name of the part. And what you'll find is, well, the 8 pins on top as well as the 8 pins at the bottom. And yeah, basically, these are the rows and columns they correspond to. They are kind of all over the place. So yeah, I guess this is probably the only thing that is a little bit not as optimal. Of course, this isn't a problem as long as you know what to connect up. Things will still work correctly. Now, interestingly, there is another challenge, and that would basically come about when we try to draw a figure like this one. Now, at face value, this seems quite simple, right? All I have to do is, of course, to power up the first row, you know, send the relevant columns to low, and then, well, those LEDs will light up, right? Repeat that for the next two rows, and yeah, you know, very nicely, the correct LEDs light up without needing us to set any other columns. The problem comes about with the next part. Now, what if I wanted to set up, you know, these two pixels, which are, you know, sort of the edges of the small? Of course, I will need to power up this row. But once we do that, a problem becomes very apparent. Because these two columns have already been set to low, the moment I switch on this row, these two are going to light up. And there's nothing I can do about that. I can't switch these off without also affecting the guys on top. Similarly, if I were to actually try and switch on the pixels here, you'll realize that once I set these two lines to low, well, extra pixels at the top light up as well, and I don't want that. So I think you can see why there is a problem here, but how do we actually solve it? As it turns out, this is kinda non-trivial. In order to solve this, we are going to have to implement quite a bit more logic that sort of brings this, you know, beyond a purely electrical thing to something in which some computational power is required. The method we're going to be using is called scanning. And let's start with everything off again. What we're going to do is we're going to switch on just the first line. Clearly, no pixels belong here, so we make sure that, you know, we don't set any of the columns to low. We switch off our first row and proceed to our second one. Now, we need to switch on these two pixels, so we set these two lines to low. Scanning to our next line again, well, we keep the same two columns to low, and that gives us our two pixels here. I think you get the idea. For the next row, we do exactly the same. Next row, nothing to see here, so none of the columns are set to low. Then we go on to our next line. Now we can safely draw these two without, you know, any other interference, because at this point of time, only these two lines are set to low. Going to our final line, now we have to light up 4 pixels, so now 4 of the lines are set to low. Finally, our last row is empty, so we don't do anything. And that is basically it for one scan. So if we were to actually step through this a little bit quicker, you will see that we are basically drawing out that smiley face. And what this means is, in order to display, you know, that particular image on screen, you're going to actually have to scroll through and scan all these lines really quickly. In fact, what you're seeing here is an example of that in action. I've also hooked up this to a little potentiometer. So what that means is, as I turn that little knob, you'll find that I'm actually changing up the scanning speed. And when things get slower, well, you can actually see that pattern of all the pixels being scanned. Alright, so earlier on we mentioned resistors, something I didn't get into, you know, the details about. But, well, now let's look at it. Let's say we have an LED. If you were to connect it directly to power, what you will get is a little mini explosion. Well, not really, but you will fry the LED. The LED will draw a large amount of current in a fleeting moment and then basically burn and, well, becomes unusable. So we don't want that. We want to actually restrict the amount of current that can actually go through the LED. And in order to do that, we add a resistor to the mix. The reason why this works is because, well, in a series circuit, the voltage is basically distributed across the components. That is, we start at, say, 5 volts, and the voltage drops until, you know, when it goes back to ground, it should be 0 volts. However, the current stays constant across, you know, all the components we have connected. And therefore, if you have something that can limit the current here, you are also limiting the current going towards the LED. Usually, a 220 ohm resistor is used. And in order to figure out what effect that has on a circuit, we make use of Ohm's law. So let's do a very quick, you know, little sample calculation here. Assuming that, you know, the potential difference across the entire circuit is 5 volts, which is incidentally what the Arduino puts out. We'll also assume that the LED has a voltage drop of 2 volts. This really depends on the LED as well as its color, so we're just going to use a very average value here. Now, since we know this and we know that voltage is distributed, the voltage across the resistor must be 3 volts. So this is where sort of Ohm's law comes into the picture here. We know the voltage, we know the resistance, we plug it in, we rearrange our equation so that we can find out the current that is flowing through the entire thing, and this gives us about 13 milliamps. So is this a good number? Well, again, it depends on the LED itself, but generally an LED can take up to 20, maybe 30 milliamps, and what that means is, well, this is a very good, fair amount. Of course, if your resistor has a lower resistance, then, well, we can get more current towards the LED, it will glow brighter. But 220 ohm is a very common resistor, and as a result, this tends to be used a lot of the time. So, why did we discuss all of this? Well, going back to our LED matrix, we clearly have to do the same, otherwise we will fry an entire row of LEDs in our matrix, and we don't want to do that. Now, at first glance, it seems to be that we can connect a resistor, you know, along the rows or along the columns, and it doesn't really matter. Well, as it turns out, there is a little consideration you have to take note of. Let's say we have our supply going through a resistor and to our LEDs, and then all our LEDs go to ground, and as a result, they all switch on. That is of course fine, right? It's completely okay, because, well, we have a resistor, nothing is going to cook itself. However, there is one problem.
let's rearrange this circuit into a, you know, slightly easier to understand form. Basically, we're creating a whole bunch of LEDs in parallel, and we have a single resistor that, you know, is limiting the current to all these LEDs. However, because this is a set of parallel circuits now, the voltage across this stays constant, but the current is actually distributed across each branch. What this means is your LEDs aren't getting, you know, a healthy 13 milliamps each. Assuming that our resistor is still a 220 ohm resistor putting out 13.6 milliamps, well, what this means is our LEDs aren't actually getting, you know, this healthy amount per LED. Instead, that amount is actually going to supply this entire stack, distributed among each LED. What this means is each LED is only taking, well, slightly less than 2 milliamps each. Your LEDs may still light up, that may still be enough to sort of get it going, but that is going to be very little, and each LED is going to be very dim at best. So we don't want to do that. We want to actually connect our resistors to the other side. In fact, the important thing is that if we are scanning, you know, along the rows, then we want to connect our resistors to the columns. The reason for this is, well, even if, you know, we have to switch on every single LED, notice that we are creating a complete path in which every path has its own resistor. At no point of time are we powering more than one LED using the same resistor. In other words, the circuitry now looks something like this. In every little one of these parallel branches, we have our own resistor. So the voltage drop across this entire part in the middle is 5 volts. And for every LED that needs to be switched on, well, it's getting the amount of current it needs. Since the resistor is only acting in a sort of localized manner. What this means then is if this current is actually coming from your Arduino, well, the more LEDs need to be switched on, the more current it's going to supply. Because we are now able to sort of vary the amount of total current that's coming out, each LED can get the amount of current it needs to operate at, well, a fair brightness. This basically wraps it up for the basics of the 8x8 LED. Of course, there is still one little problem, and that is a crazy number of pins are required to drive the display. I used an Arduino Nano earlier on, and that certainly doesn't have the 16 pins needed for this. So the question is there a way to reduce on the number of pins required? And there you have it. Do think about that last question. How can we sort of, you know, economize on the amount of pins that we are actually using here? And to what extent can we do that? The only hint that we're going to give you regarding this is that, well, we've actually already taken a look at this before. It's just that next time when we actually return to the subject, we'll apply that in a slightly different way. That's all there is for this particular episode. Thank you very much for watching, and until next time, you're watching 0612 TV with NERDfirst.net. Thank you very much for watching. If you like my work and are feeling generous, you can shoot me a one-time donation on PayPal or sign up for a recurring one on Patreon. Of course, you can simply like, comment, and subscribe. You know the deal. For more videos, links to my channel and a related playlist are on screen. Thank you for your support.